You're watching VH1's 8 Days of 80's, a week so big, we added an extra day.
The stars.
The song is almost thought control.
The real scoop.
It had nothing to do with sex.
Old favorites. With a new spin. From the artist. Who hit it big in the 80s. And boom, the song hit me like that. The 80s. Skinny leather tie under every turned-up collar. Copy of Working Class Dog in every album collection. Yes, the decade was very good to me, as it was for Greg Kinn, Mr. Mister, Survivor, and Tommy Two-Tone, too. We all hit it big in the 80s. And for the next hour, we're going to play and tell you about the songs that put us on top. We'll start with Billy Squire. For Billy, being a rock star was more than just a teenage dream. It was a mission, and he had what it took. The chops, the hair, but most importantly, songs. From his debut in 1980 until the end of the decade, Billy cut 8 albums and mined a generous pile of platinum. His most prized, his second, 1981's Don't Say No. It's Billy's biggest selling album thanks to a stroke of his songwriting genius.
The winner boy moved quite well. The implicit sexual innuendo was something that allows me to sort of to be provocative and also state some, you know, whatever it is that I want to discuss at that time with sex. What you aim right in the mind. But I knew that people would interpret that way, and it was fine. I'm trying to bed me. You try to backbone slide. You made my backbone slide. Find your bread me, skip on by. When you find your bread me, I'll skip on by. I mean, for me, that song was more about self-interest, you know, and the ravages, the cruelties that come with self-interest.
So now we know what it's all about. Let's check it out. From 1981, here's Billy Squire with The Stroke.
Now everybody, get aboard.
While The Stroke broke Billy Squire in 1981, another 80s rocker was getting his big break at the same time. That's when Greg Kinn's breakup song became his first hit. But it only scratched the surface of what was to come. If there's one word to describe Greg in the 80s, it has to be kinetic. In 10 years, he cut 9 albums, shot 7 music videos, and toured constantly. Through the decade, one thing stayed consistent, his album title. Remember Conspiracy? It's the one that gave us Greg's biggest hit.
Where were you when I needed you? You could not be found.
I remember the day I wrote Jeopardy. Steve Wright came over to my house, and he had just purchased one of these old Casio keyboards, and he's real proud. He's playing this riff with the little drum beat in there, and boom, the song hit me like that.
As a warning, a ticket in the way you lie.
He started playing the chords, and I just started singing off the top of my head.
Our love's in jeopardy, baby. Our love's in jeopardy, baby.
We just looked at each other, and the song wrote itself.
Our love's in jeopardy, baby.
So I had an inkling that Jeopardy was special, real early. I think we were on the road with Journey. And we were out there for quite some time, a couple of months. And while we were out there, we were listening to that rough thing that I did, and everybody was loving it.
Oh, what's the use? Save your money now.
So we came back from the tour, and we cut it pretty much in maybe 1 or 2 takes.
Don't let go while I'm hanging on, cause I've been hanging on so long.
Every time I go out and do Jeopardy, for some reason I think of my second ex-wife. And occasionally, it produces an unpleasant taste in my mouth.
Yeah.
I love seeing Jeopardy.
A lot of times I'll flash on the video. Because Jeopardy was such, you know, like such an unusual video in its day, and every time I do it, I still see zombies. You know, I could be playing a concert, and I like the people start turning into zombies. Yeah, real weird. In retrospect, I'm really glad it never got to number one, actually, and it couldn't get past Michael Jackson. And, you know, in retrospect, I think, you know, Michael really needed the money that year. It was a tough year for him. I obviously have gone on to bigger and better things.
I love you, Jeopardy, Jeopardy.
So that ghoul-filled video Greg was talking about, he said the concept was autobiographical. I wonder which one of his weddings inspired him. From 1983, here's Jeopardy.
Where are you? When I need you.
Jeopardy was big in the 80s, and would you believe it's huge in the 90s, at least in Greece. You see, somebody remixed the song and released it, now it's a hit in the Athens dance clubs. Hey, Athens, you know, Jesse's Girl has a pretty good groove. Speaking of Jesse's Girl, I got my guitar. A little later, I'll play Jesse's Girl. So be warned and tell you a little secret about that song. Plus, Tommy's got a song and a story about a girl you might remember.
Janet, Janet, you're the girl for me.
That's coming up on Big in the 80s. But first, one of my good friends bears his soul about one of his band's biggest songs.
In a way, I sort of was against that song, believe it or not.
Can I play too?
Full of wicked fun. It's the hottest since Basic Instinct.
You're good, you know that.
Kevin Bacon, Matt Dillon, Nev Campbell, Wild Things. Directed by John McNaughton, rated R. Opens tomorrow.
This is Big in the 80s. VH1's hour-long tribute to the songs that defined a decade. I'm Rick Springfield. One thing that defined music in the 80s was technology. Was the age of synthesizers and sequencers. But if you didn't watch out, your songs could get consumed by electronics. One band that successfully married 80s super production with solid songwriting was Mr. Mister. You might not remember the band's first album, and their third ended up being their last, but what came in the middle earned Mr. Mister the kind of success four accomplished musicians deserved. A number one album and three top 10 singles. And while Broken Wings was the first song to soar to number one, the follow-up had a spirit that rose above its top spot on the charts.
The wind blows hard against the closing sky. Across the sea into my soul.
In a way, I sort of was against that song, believe it or not, when we first wrote it.
Stretching my feet upon the road.
I had come up with the little verse thing and the bass line and stuff, and John Lang, who wrote lyrics with us, he had somehow come up with this idea of Kyrie Eleison, which is Greek, it's from the Catholic Mass, meaning Lord have mercy.
Kyrie Eleison down the road that I must travel.
And he said, just try this. And I feel uncomfortable doing this. I don't really want to make a religious statement here. And he said, forget about it. Just sing it. See if it works. So I started singing it. And it was one of those things where no matter if I wanted to change it, I couldn't. It just became the song. That was the song. I remember this to me in a supermarket once, and he said, hey, you knew that song Kyrie, right? I said, yeah, and he goes, but you got a girl, right? Another guy thought it was Carry a Laser, or Carry a Raisin, or something, you know.
Killing is where I'm going, you follow. Killing is an older highway in the
line. It didn't really matter what it was about, at the point. People just liked it.
So if you ever thought Richard was singing Carry a Razor, no, he wasn't. Although now we got that cleared up. Here's Mr. Mister from 1985's Welcome to the Real World. This is Curie.
The wind blows hard against this mountainside. Across the sea into my soul. It reaches in to where I cannot hide. Setting my feet upon the road.
Well, Mr. Mister's Kyrie lifted our spirits. Survivor's Eye of the Tiger got us pumped up.
I knew what it was going to be, a phenomenon, you know, as far as the movie, and he could feel the power of...
We'll find out more about this rock and roll fight song. Then John Cafferty takes us back to the dark side, right here on Big in the 80s. You loved the songs, but never knew the stories behind them until now. This is VH1's Big in the 80s, and I'm Rick Springfield. Feathered hair and leather pants aside, the rock and roll business is a lot like the world of boxing. There's a struggle for a shot at a title, and then, if you're lucky to get it and win it, there's a battle to stay on top. Nobody knows this more than a lean Chicago band who, back in 1982, landed a knockout on the charts. Survivor first stepped into the ring in 1980. Before the decade was done, the guys punched out 8 albums and a handful of hits. But it was that shot at Sylvester Stallone's Rocky III that won the band its heavyweight pop title.
I felt when we were recording it that we really, I felt that it was going to be, you know, significant. I really did. You don't say that too often, you think it's going to be a hit record, but I really actually did think it would be.
It took us about a week or two to actually come up with the title. I don't know where we were, on the road or nowhere at the health club, and how about Eye of the Tiger? Yeah, that should work.
I'm hanging tough. I'm staying home.
We're writing about what's going on with us at the time. You know, we're paying dues, we're a rock band, we're, you know, you're clawing at the clay, you're climbing the riverbank, all those cliches that you hear, they're true.
It's like the ice till we take to the sea. Just a man and a will to survive.
The demo track is what's in the film. The demonstration. We couldn't get the. We were recording the record at the same time, so there was just no way in hell we were going to be able to get that one done.
I knew what it was going to be, a phenomenon, you know, as far as the movie. And you could feel the power of that whole thing going with the movie.
That was like a trip. I thought that was really weird, man. We had the right thing at the right time. It's that timing thing. You get the luck, the timing, and Eye of the Tiger came out of it.
Well, there's nothing bluesy about the original. In fact, Sylvester Stallone told Survivor he wanted something with a pulse. So they gave him this from 1982. Here's Eye of the Tiger. Tiger. In 1982, that song was everywhere, and a year later, another song from a movie soundtrack ruled the radio. This one came from a little clock-punching bar band from Providence, Rhode Island, that could and did.
John Cafferty and the Beaver Brown Band spent years paying their dues up and down the East Coast. Then in 1983, the band's ship finally came in. Over the next 2 years, the guys turned out four top 40 singles. But one, their very first, serves as an anthem to the band's blue jeans and t-shirt brand of rock and roll.
Dark Side, I mean, just straight up rock and roll song. I wrote that for the movie. It was just a scene where the piano player, who was the guy who wrote the lyrics to the song, he liked the guitar player's girlfriend. It was just a very literal description of what the scene in the movie was. From out of the shadows, she walked like a dream. And it just described like how he felt inside when he saw her. For the longest time, I mean, that's sort of what On the Dark Side was to me. It was just part of the script. But then when we made the record, it was beyond just a piece for the film. It just had like some little rock and roll life to it. First time I heard On the Dark Side on the radio, I mean, I just was really proud of the band. When I saw it in the film, I mean, I had a different reaction because it was like all of a sudden my voice was coming out of somebody else's face, you know what I mean? Which is like, it just sort of looked a little odd to me, you know? People come and see us like every night, you know, anywhere, everywhere, USA. You know, they're looking for us to play On the Dark Side, and we come out, we do it, and people get up, and they feel good when they hear it, and they dance, and they jump around, and it's like, you know, and so do we.
So John and the guys shot the video for their hit at a club in Boston called The Channel. Here it is, from 1983. This is On the Dark Side. On the Dark Side did for John Cafferty what this next song did for Tommy Two Tone. You know the number, but you know the deal behind these seven digits.
It's a real phone number, a real person in Jenny.
Tommy tells us the whole story next on Big in the 80s. Stories, you're getting it all right here on VH1's Big in the 80s. I'm Rick Springfield. You know, if there was a Mount Rushmore for 80s bands, Tommy Two Tone would get a pretty big piece of the rock. After all, he is the guy that gave us that phone number, you know, the one for good time. He only released three albums and never had a number one song. But what Tommy achieved can't be measured on the charts. In 1981, Tommy Two Tone took five chords and seven digits and turned them into gold. Gold that'll forever hold its pop culture luster.
I never knew there were so many people named Jennifer in the country.
Give me something I could hold on to.
There's something about that song that was just, like you say, it has its own vibe. Even now today, people can tell me where they were when they first heard the song.
Saw your name and number on the wall.
It's a real phone number, a real person named Jenny. She's very nice. A woman who, was in the music business, actually, and she gave me the phone number.
Jenny, don't change your number. It's 675-09.
supposed to use those official 555 numbers. I'm really sorry for all the people whose lives we ruined. They had that phone number.
Janet, you're the girl.
Oh, we had people all over the country. We had the chief of police's daughter, phone number in Buffalo, New York.
You don't know me, but you make me so darn
new. And a junior high in West Virginia.
Tried to call you before, but I lost my nerve.
A bunch of people down in Texas, I heard a lot of stories.
I tried my imagination, but I was disdained.
Several of whom tried to sue us.
Johnny, I've got your number.
People magazine thought that they'd get us back, and so they put our phone numbers in their article about it.
Change your number, 8675099.
I think I have some I can relate now.
8675099.
The song is almost thought control. I mean, you just repeat the same thing over and over.
8675099.
It had the humor and it had something you could really get into and sing.
5309.
It was really fun to sing. It's still fun to sing.
Well, as you could probably tell, Tommy's kind of a shy guy, and he admits that. In fact, he says he's nothing like the singer he is on stage or in his videos. From 1981, here's a bolder Tommy T-Tone, 8675309.